So again, my name is Roberto Rivera, the youth that I have the privilege of mentoring around the nation. Call me Big Bro. My title officially is I am the Executive Director of the Alliance for the Seventh Generation. And we create thriving educational ecosystems by, for, and with youth. So engaging young folks as leaders in their communities from New York to Casa Grande, we're doing some work in Casa Grande, to folks in California and New Zealand. And I'm really excited to partner with you all, not just today for the conference, but also to partner long-term in creating this global network of young leaders, because we need y'all today. So I've entitled this talk, From Pain to Propane. As Ken said, you know, this has been a very difficult time to be alive on planet Earth. But I believe that you all are on the precipice of being able to change the narrative and the tune. We'll get into that in a minute, and how we can start to shift from a surviving mindset, as Kaylee was talking about, to this growth mindset that embraces this idea of thriving, right? And so I'm gonna kick this off with a quote from Howard Thurman. They said that Dr. King, he would walk around with two different books. One book, of course, being Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., he had the Bible, right? But the other book was a book that was written by a theologian, by an activist, by someone he considered a mentor, and that's Howard Thurman. And so Howard Thurman says, don't ask what the world needs. Rather, ask what makes you come alive, because what the world needs are people who have come alive. I love this quote for a lot of different reasons. One of the reasons is that the reality is that there is something inside of you that the world desperately needs, that the world is not complete if this part of you, this passion is not fostered and nurtured and released. The other thing is that the world is aching. The world is aching to be a better place. And part of making this world a better place is you being your authentic self. So I know a lot of us are maybe not in a room with other people, but if you happen to be in a room with some other folks, shout across the room, say, you know, I don't know about you, but there's something inside of me that the world needs, and I'm gonna let that thing out, all right? And so as we think about youth voice, if we think about youth leadership, the reality is that every major social movement in the last 50 years that have been successful have had young people leading these initiatives. We talked about Dr. King, but if you reread the people's history of civil rights, the reason why civil rights was so successful was not because of a few exemplary individuals like King and Rosa Parks and Ella Baker. The real core engine of this movement was young people who were boarding buses going down south, who were sitting at lunch counters, who were being hosed down in the streets. It was young folks who made this movement a possibility. If we look at other places around the globe, if we look at South Africa and the ending of apartheid, this is legalized racial segregation. Part of what's important to understand is that history was made by young people challenging the educational system. They called it the Bantu system of education. And challenging that system was part of taking out the three-legged stool, if you will, of apartheid in South Africa. Or if we look at Brazil, they were doing a lot of different budget cuts. Raise your hand if you've ever experienced some budget cuts, either to your school or to some social service industry that you're a part of. You got a hands up from Annika, thank you. And so these youth, in partnership with elders, ended up getting the Brazilian Congress to adopt the UN's rights of a child. And after they adopted that, they were able to get these budgets reinstated. And family, this isn't just stuff that's happened historically. This is stuff that is happening now, from the Black Lives Matters movement to the Dias Sin Latinos movement, to young folks helping to reinstate DACA, to Miss Malala, who was the first teenager to ever win the Nobel Peace Prize. I think about Greta Thunberg as well, that we have these young leaders who are emerging, and this is happening and needing to happen now more than ever before. Maybe there are some of you who are watching this live or who will watch a recording of this, and maybe you're in a situation where you're like, man, I'm being in this involved with this stuff, but I don't really think I'm a leader. You know, me and my friends, we've been through too much to be an agent for good, to be an agent for change. And I want to challenge that idea real quick. And I want to challenge that by sharing a story about a good friend of mine named Carlos. And so Carlos's story, you know, begins with a young guy who in elementary school was told he was learning deficient. And in middle school, he knew he was good at something, but the only people who would give him the attention and the support were drug dealers. So his misdirected entrepreneurship skills got him kicked out of middle school. He ran away from home, he got arrested, and at the age of 14, my friend tried to kill himself. Fortunately, he was not successful, and there's another side of the coin of the story, and that is, Carlos told me, he said, "Big bro, I realized I wasn't LD learning deficient. I was LD, I learned different." I said, "Ooh, I like that." And he started applying this learning difference, this kind of growth mindset that Kaylee was talking about, to school. And he started doing really well. Was the first person in his family to graduate from high school, eventually created his own social enterprise, a community-based organization. And now my friend, who was told he was LD, is wrapping up a PhD in education. Now, family, the reason why I share this story with you, and I could share a lot of stories, but this one is very personal to me because it's the story of not just any Carlos, but the story of Roberto Carlos Rivera. This is my story. And so, you know, I was a kid who did feel helpless and hopeless. And now today I stand before you as a big bro who feels hopeful and hopefully a little bit helpful too. And it's really been quite a journey for me to get to this place. And, you know, like Kevin was saying, it required me to learn how to think critically about the world around me. It required me, like Kaylee, to find that creative spark and to let that be released. It required me, as Bob is creating this platform for you all, to really authentically have a voice and to shape the places and spaces that I was a part of. And so we've been taking this idea of engaging our critical, creative, and collaborative skills and sharing it with youth around the nation. And we've seen young people similar to Carlos, who have turned that pain into propane, who've created their own clothing lines, who have created businesses that are making hundreds of thousands of dollars a year, and that they're using part of these profits to reinvest in their community. Some of these young folks have created cultural centers in their neighborhoods, places that, you know, were a desert for expression for young people. And so at one point, I want to share with you a little bit about the Firehouse Community Arts Center. Also, these young folks have created block parties that have persisted over the years. And now I'm working with some young folks in New York who are on a mission to create their own school. And so, as what has been shared earlier, we are living in a very interesting time, right? And some researchers, some scholars are saying that this is such a historical time that if we don't process through some of the grief, that this could have what they call an impact that causes post-apocalyptic stress syndrome, meaning that this could potentially impact, according to their research, 200 years of people's lives from now, right? And so they kind of borrow from the research of what happened with the Black Plague in Europe and saying that, you know, if folks don't learn how to heal, then, you know, they could have different health conditions. They could be more prone to drugs and alcohol, right? And so we've lost nearly 600,000 people in the US due to COVID-19. And also the pandemic has highlighted that there's been a lot of inequities in our nation for a long time. And a lot of this has come to the forefront, particularly as we see how Black folks make up 13% of the population, yet 33% of those who are getting the virus and 34% of all deaths. And part of the reason why this is happening is because we're learning that folks of color have been marginalized, that they've been not able to access quality health care the same as some of the white counterparts in this nation are. In addition to that, the impacts of racism are impacting folks' capability to get over the virus, and their immune system becomes compromised. And so that's a contributing factor. The Latinx community, we are 84% of the essential workers. And consequently, we are catching COVID-19 at 5 times the rate of our white counterparts. Our brothers and sisters at the Navajo Nation have been the hardest hit in the nation per capita. And all of that has been happening in addition to the senseless murders of boys and young men of color by the hands of white officers. Thinking about Adam Toledo, who was shot in the chest, he was 12 years old. Of course, George Floyd, Dwayne Wright. So what I wanna do, family, is just take a moment to honor all the loss of life, folks who have been taken from us. So let's just take a minute and just offer up a moment of silence for those who have been taken before their time. So family, I come today not with the message of death and despair, but a message of healing and hope. And yes, there is a possibility for post-traumatic stress syndrome or post-traumatic stress disorder, but there's also the possibility of post-traumatic growth. And more of us are probably familiar with the idea of resilience. And resilience and post-traumatic growth are similar in that they both care about folks who've had a setback. Resilience is about coming back to where you were before that adverse experience. Post-traumatic growth is the phenomenon where people flip that pain into propane and they experience more purpose, more empowerment, clarity of the direction of their lives, closer relationships. And so it's clear that there are things that can be done that can help folks go from surviving to thriving. And some of these things, these essential elements, are that young folks need to have relationships with adults other than parents who they can go to in a time of crisis, who can push them to taking positive risk. Also, it's important for young people and everyone, for that matter, to know that they have a spark, something that they're passionate about, something that they're good at. And I touched on this earlier, as did some others, that it's important to know that you have a voice and that your voice matters. And it matters not just tomorrow when you graduate or graduate from college or you can vote. We need your voice now. And so the research is clear that young folks who have these three things are more likely to thrive and do well in school and in work and in life. They're going to be less depressed. They're going to be more empowered. But the research also suggests, looking at thousands of young people that they've surveyed, that only 7% of youth have these three things. Now, I'm not the best at math, but doing the math here quickly, that's 93% of young people in the U.S. who are not thriving. And so myself and Dr. Juan Carlos Arauz out of the Bay Area, we felt challenged by some of this research. And so we said, not on our watch. There's gotta be a way to operationalize these ideas, particularly for our young people of color, particularly in a way that prioritizes racial equity. So we talk about the need for critical relationships, And I'll talk about sampling consciousness in a minute. But how do we build transformative relationships that nurture a critical consciousness and a positive identity? Looking at cultural sparks, and we'll talk about remixing your gift in a minute, but how do we discover our strengths, our intelligences, and learn to flex these abilities in school and in work and in life? And then looking at voice, it needs to be amplified. We need to learn how to spit bars to split bars. In other words, how do we promote such authentic youth voice that it changes the narratives and brings liberation not only to individuals, but to the collective community as well? And so part of how I conceptualize in hip hop, hip producers like Kanye or DJ Premier, or maybe you know DJ Khaled. And so what they do is they end up going through a lot of classical records. It might be some Motown that maybe your parents listen to or grandparents, maybe it's some salsa, maybe it's something obscure. And so they find something that they like. And what happened, make sure y'all can hear this. Give me a thumbs up if you can hear any of the sounds coming through here. So as a producer is making a new song, he or she will look for some piece of music, some excerpt that speaks to them. And then they'll bring that into their MPC, their beat maker, and they'll loop it, right? But if you play that loop over and over, it gets a little redundant. It gets a little boring. So what you have to do is you have to add your remix. You got to add your spin. Maybe you'll add some bass. Maybe you'll add some drums to it, but you're going to create a new track, a new kind of music. And the goal is to attract people who can then lay some vocals over that so that you create a song. And in the same way, a producer is hoping that that song is going to move the crowd and maybe even make some change. They're hoping to sell some units. So this is what one producer did to that excerpt. Maybe you've heard this song before.
I'm living in that 21st century, doing something mean to it. Do it better than anybody you ever seen do it. Screams from the haters, got a nice ring to it. I guess every superhero need his theme music. No one man should have all that power. The clock's ticking, I just count the hours. Stop tripping, I'm tripping off the power.
The reality is that right now, you are having an opportunity to create the song of your life. And there's a lot of different noise that's trying to come in and trying to influence how you produce this song. There's politicians, there's the media, there's different samples that are trying to leak into your track that are trying to say that, you know, you shouldn't really have a voice. You're really not that powerful. You're not a real contributor to this society. But the reality is, family, you're the one producing the track. And so in order to take authorship of this track, you have to be really conscientious of who are you going to sample from and how can you sample consciousness? In other words, who are the people that you want to sample their example and incorporate that into how you play out your life? Are there some records of history, some different heroes and heroines that you want to also sample from and bring into your track? And in addition to that, we don't want to just, you know, mimic people, right? So we have to bring our own authentic spin. So what is your remix? What is your passion? What are the things that you love to do? And how do you add that flavor to your song? And ultimately, allow yourself to have a voice so that you can move the crowd and maybe make a change and maybe make enough of an impact that future generations will see your example and want a sample from your life. And so I just want to take a moment, family, and I want to just get a chance to reflect. Has anything been said so far that resonates with you? Has anything come up that you still have questions about? And if so, I would love to just have you either take yourself off of mute, or if you want to add something into the comment box, that would be great. I'm just trying to pull up the comment box here, the chat box. So is there anything that resonates? Is there anything that you still have questions about?
I think most people are gonna have to put it in the chat just because I don't know if they can share their mic.
Okay, perfect.
I just wanted to say really quick, thank you so much for recognizing the racial inequities within COVID-19, how minority groups was most affected by COVID-19 because of the lack of healthcare and whatnot. So thank you for mentioning that within your presentation.
Absolutely, Annika. And you know, our conversation that we had earlier in the week, y'all helped to co-create some of this message too. So, you know, you get some of the credit for that right on back. All right, I'm not seeing any comments or questions. But if y'all want to go a little bit deeper with me, say deeper. A little higher, say higher. Put that in the chat. Take yourself off mute if you can. All right. Deeper, yes, please. All right. So we talk a little bit about creating the song of your life, creating the soundtrack for thriving in Casa Grande, right? And we're going to talk about how do we sample consciousness? How do we build these kinds of relationships that nurture this critical consciousness, this cultural identity? And so again, you know, I'm kind of like a DJ with one turntable. I'm going to share a little bit of research with y'all. And on the other turntable, I'm going to share some real life with y'all as well. Hopefully those two can come together in a way that equips you to creating this kind of context for thriving at Casa Grande. So again, the research says young people, particularly teenagers, that y'all need to have folks in your life other than parents that you can sample from, folks that can support you to taking positive risks. Could be Bob Shogren, I don't know. Could be Joe Martinez, I don't know. Jeff Lavender, if anybody goes to Valago. It could be different teachers or coaches, people in the community that you can go to for support. But again, the research is clear that only 19% of young folks have even one person that they can go to in a time of crisis. And so that's 81% that don't have this kind of support. And so part of the reason I think there's a breakdown, it's not that you all are not around adults, because you are around adults a lot of the time. It's just that I think too many adults default to becoming old people instead of becoming elders, right? And so old people don't have the ability of seeing youth really as the solution. They still have in the back of their mind that you might be part of the problem. And as a result, these old people are not very vulnerable. They don't open up. And when it comes time for you all to take action, old people like to play the background. An elder, in contrast, sees young people and knows that they can become part of the solution. They're willing to be more vulnerable and they share what worked and what didn't work and allow you to improvise off of what they share. And when it comes time to taking action, elders, they got your back. They will lock arms with you. They will help you to walk this thing out. I call the quality of being a real elder is someone who has Michelangelo vision. And maybe you know about Michelangelo and Donatello and Raphael and Master Splinter all eating pizza, but that's not the Michelangelo I'm talking about. I'm talking about the Renaissance man, you know, who did the Sistine Chapel, who did the Pietà and did these masterpieces. And as a story goes, he was trying to teach some of his students and how to become master sculptors. And I don't know if he went to a Youth Alliance conference, but he learned how to do project-based learning. He gave them a stone. And these young folks are in this great hall with all these masterpieces, and they start chipping away at the stone. They were trying to make their masterpiece. Finally, some time passes, and you know, they step back to admire their masterpiece, and it looked like something out of a horror movie, right? So my rendition, they come over to Mike. They say, "Hey, yo, Mike," and they throw their tools down. They say, "Man, how do you create something so ugly? How do you create something so beautiful out of something so ugly? How do you create something so precious out of something so worthless?" And Michelangelo looks at him, and he's got this teachable moment, and he says, I want you to understand something. I'm not creating anything." And they're like, "What?" He says, "No." He says, "First, I build a relationship with a stone, and then my job is easy." He says, "I seek to chip away at the rough pieces that have trapped the sculpture." And so that really hit me when I did a little research and I found out that the root word for education comes from the Latin term educere, which means to bring out that which is already there. And so part of the keys to not just education, but community transformation is really a twofold process. One is, can we see the beautiful sculpture that's already there, right? Can we build that relationship so that we can see all that beauty and brilliance? And secondly, can we create an experience where the folks we're teaching or the community that we're engaging can see that beauty and brilliance for themselves? One of the beautiful lenses that I like to use in cultivating Michelangelo vision is this idea of community cultural wealth. And this amazing woman named Tara Yoso talks about, yes, we can be wealthy beyond just financial resources and financial capital, that there are six different forms of being rich and having various forms of capital. And so starting with the pink circle at the bottom, we have linguistical capital, the way that we can speak different languages, or like Kaylee was using poetry, or some folks, you know, have that with videography or other forms of art. There's also resistant capital. As we are undergoing oppression, as Annika was talking about some of the racial inequalities, how are we gonna deal with that? Are we gonna use that fire of oppression to go burn other people? Or can we use that fire in a transformative way to illuminate, to build, to heal? Then there's navigational capital. Many of the systems in our society were not created with people of color in mind. They were made for a very different population. And so how do we navigate through these systems? And how do we not just survive, but how do we thrive? And part of the key for that is social capital. Who are the champions? Who are the folks that can give us some of the knowledge and skills and how to effectively navigate through? Familia capital, not just the people that you share DNA with, but the folks that we have a shared sense of values with, that we may call coach or auntie or uncle or tia or primo, right? Folks that you have a real bond with. And finally, there's aspirational capital. And that's us having a capability to dream beyond our current circumstances. And so for me, family, my Michelangelo was my grandfather. And so as a former middle school student who was kicked out, who made a bunch of mistakes, I got locked up, I went to drug rehab. Everybody kind of treated me like this stone. And yet there was one man, and that was my grandfather, who didn't treat me like the stone. He treated me like the sculpture. He treated me like I could be a community leader one day. He treated me like I might create my own community-based organization. He treated me when I was 15 like I might give a keynote to the Casa Grande Alliance one day virtually. And he made me feel that there was something of value, even though I couldn't see that in myself. And so as I was trying to catch a reflection of what my grandfather saw, before I can quite see what he saw, he had a heart attack and he passed. And I remember going to the funeral. I wasn't sure if this was my reason for giving up on life. And I remember I went there just feeling open, like, okay, let's see how this goes. You know, maybe this might be it. And so I remember the whole cathedral was packed, full of family members, There was a lot of people also I didn't know. But I got to hear my grandfather's story being narrated through the family and how they talked about how a son of immigrants who grew up on a farm had a dream to get an education. Even though no one on the farm or in his community was really doing that, they made fun of him for wanting to be educated. He had to leave the comfort of his farm to confront his destiny. And with a few dollars in his pocket, like Kevin said, you know, he had to walk uphill both to and from school every day. One of these, you know, old school stories. But he eventually graduated, got a decent job, and started sending money back so his brothers and sisters could also have a crack at an education. And then there was the receiving line, and I got to shake hands with different people that my grandfather had touched, and not in a weird perverted way, like he'd be on Jerry Springer or something, but people that he had served in secret, people that he had mentored through the Big Brothers and Big Sisters organization, folks that he had worked with different not-for-profits, and even folks he had given small partial scholarships to who were from the same community that made fun of him for having a dream and going after his education. And it clicked because I realized that my grandfather, he had some pain in his life. And I realized in that moment that he saw my pain, he saw my passion, and he knew that one day these could combine in a way that could give life and voice to an authentic purpose. And it was that day, family, that I decided I was never going to sell drugs ever again. I wanted to leave a positive legacy, just like he did. And that was the day everything changed. And so shortly after that day, I wrote a piece. And if it's okay, could I share a little piece of poetry? Are y'all still there? I can't see nobody. Maybe I'm talking to myself. If you want to hear some poetry, say, yeah. If you want to hear a little flowetry, put it in the chat. Say, okay, let's get it. For sure. Joe Martinez up here. What's up, bro? Okay. So here's this piece. I haven't done it in a while, but it goes like this. Fire, fire, fire. Watch out, y'all. It's a really big fire. And this fire burns so bright, it could burn off your eyebrows if you look at it too long. This fire is so hot, it could set you ablaze if you consider taking a step any closer. This fire is so wild, it will melt all of your silly tools and instruments if you ever consider trying to study this. Y'all want to know what started this fire? Casa Grande? Y'all want to know? It was a bunch of painful sparks. Like that time, those dudes down the block jumped you and left you for dead in the cold. Spark. Or that time your dad came home drunk and smacked you and left you crying with blood coming out your nose. Spark. Or what about that other time you got pulled over for not stopping all the way at a stop sign? The cop wanted to search your car and strip search you on the side of the road, even though he couldn't find any drugs. Or what about that time you went over to your girlfriend's house and caught her kicking it with her old boyfriend? Spark. Or what about the time you were just walking down the street and you fit the description, so the police picked you up and took you downtown and had you in a lineup? Spark. Or that time that teacher humiliated you in front of the whole class and said, no, we're not going to have Roberto read because he's just slow. Spark. 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 Flame. You started skipping school. You started getting drunk. You started smoking weed and manipulating girls. Man, I saw you. You made your heart hard like you just didn't care anymore. Nah, nah, nah. See, now it's time that they be the ones yelling fire. It's time that they be the ones that's scared. It's time that they be the ones running around concerned about having everything that they care for destroyed. Roberto, what are you doing? Now you becoming the thing you most hate. Now you're the one who's unjustly hurting the innocent. And don't you see what being gone's doing to your brother? The pain you were inflicting on your mother? You don't see any responsibility in what you do? Look at your friends, they're trying to be just like you. They're trying to prove they can earn your respect. and the alcoholic drug dealers. Don't you see your effect? If you only knew how long this would affect their life, you would check yourself, because what you on, it ain't right. Nah, dude, you ain't right. I ain't conspiring to put your fire out, because I do believe that this fire can inspire you and become your energy. It can fuel the vehicle of your greatest dreams, igniting passion as it moves you with steam. Moving you towards production, challenging the system. Otherwise, it instructs you to produce more victims. Fire can burn down a building, leaving it void, or for a greater purpose. When it is employed, when poised, it can cook, run cars that heat a home, or it can kill, burn, and start a destructive syndrome. It can light up a situation. It can clean. It can burn down condemnation and reveal your dream. A coward lets his fire burn everything like coal, but real power is demonstrated when your fire is controlled. I said a coward lets his fire burn everything like coal, but real power is demonstrated when your fire is controlled. Controlled. Control, man, I'm losing control. I've been burned, now I'm just burning up everybody else around me. But is it too late? Casa Grande Alliance, is it too late? Yo, I ain't becoming the thing that I most hate. I'm switching on my game, no, it ain't too late. I'ma make this decision with precision to change. I'ma switch up my mission to reposition my flame. My vision's aimed to write poems to enlighten domes. To bring freedom now as I write songs. No longer to light bongs and fight moms. I'm using my fight to inspire, to light the dawn. Right and wrongs, no longer a crook that steals. I'm cooking soul meals, bringing something that can heal. Bringing that real love in this world to pretend. Burning the lies that blind all of my friends. Letting this light extend in this world is oh so dark. Writing so boys and girls might redirect their spark and embark. To break the chains, to make a change, to change the game, to go against the grain. I'ma make this confession that is so real. We've all been burned with rejection, and we need to be healed, but even burned, we can learn to use it as a tool. And we can be a light, even right in these schools. Be a light for peace, be a light for justice. Let your anger be released, let's fight this destruction. Coming out this dungeon of this world full of victims, aiming at the root, we sure to change the system. Ain't it strange to believe I could change the world if I first change me? Ain't it strange to believe we can change this world and leave a legacy like that? Thank you. So family, what elders, the adults who are here, how can you be the best elder that you can be to your youth? How can you be vulnerable about the pain even in your own life and how you've had to turn that pain into a fuel, how you've had to find a way to keep going on even when it hurts? And have you done the work of seeing the cultural wealth of your students? I'm gonna put in the chat here after the keynote, a tool that we've created that allows you to see all the forms of beautiful cultural capital that young people are carrying with them every day. And for the young folks who are here, I want you to consider who can be a mentor to you. Who is an elder that you can ask to support you in this time? And reciprocally, who can you be a elder to, a young elder to? Because if you're in high school, you have middle school and elementary school youth who are looking up to you. And so I want you to also take a look at this tool that we've created. It's like a worksheet. And you can use it to identify some of the strengths and some of the beautiful things that are in those younger youth who are in your community. If you are willing to take this challenge to not only go after a mentor, but to be a mentor and to start seeing the beauty and brilliance in the people around you, I want you to respond via the chat. Let me know, are you willing to take the challenge? I'm planning to come down to Casa Grande, so you know, we'll be seeing each other face to face. Anybody willing to take the challenge? Not even one?
Someone actually got a question for you in the chat. It's tips on becoming a better leader.
Tips on what?
Becoming a better leader.
Tips on being a better leader. You know, I heard this definition of leadership, and, you know, it to me just really resonated. You know, the true leadership is seeing people's potential so clearly that you can help them to see that potential in themselves. And so that fits perfectly with this idea of Michelangelo vision. You know, a true leader doesn't just have people following him or her. A true leader creates other leaders, right? And that oftentimes requires the initial step of seeing something in somebody that they maybe don't quite see in themselves quite yet, and giving them opportunities, giving them experiences. We say, oh man, you, Annika, you thought I could do this for the youth comp? I didn't know if I could do it, but I did it, right? And then this person is like, man, Annika is leading me to being my more empowered, authentic self. That's leadership. They're becoming a leader, paying it forward, doing the same thing. So I hope that helps. Any other questions? Or you know, anybody got any criticism too? Because, hey, I'm open to that as well. And I don't know how we're doing on time. So y'all let me know. But if y'all want to go a little deeper, I'd love to go a little deeper with you and share how some young folks created their own cultural center. If y'all want to hear that,
let me know. I think that sounds interesting, and we've got about 2 minutes left. Just an FYI.
How many?
30.
30, okay. Okay. All right, so we're going to keep going. So we're going to talk about the cultural sparks, remixing your gifts, taking these strengths, these intelligences, and learning how to flex them in school and in life. And, you know, a quote that kind of stood out to me as I was thinking about this conference was this one by Buckminster Fuller. And he says, all children are born geniuses. However, 9,999 out of every 10,000 are swiftly and inadvertently de-geniusized by grownups. What do y'all think about this quote? Is it true? And if it is true, what a tragedy. Let me tell you something. It is no small quest to become an adult, to become an elder, and to not be de-geniusized, right? And so part of what Bob and Joe and Kevin and other leaders in Casa Grande are trying to do is create an environment where you all don't grow up and have your wings clipped and you're not de-geniusized. Alex says, yes, adults limit youth and their experiences and try to fit them into the mold of what is deemed as normal or just right. And normal is boring. Normal is outdated. The reality is, family, that 65% of elementary school students, y'all gonna end up in a job that hasn't been created yet. 50% of middle school and high school students, y'all are gonna be doing something that we can't even imagine right now. And one of the things that's a prerequisite for getting the jobs of tomorrow is being creative and bringing this multi-dimensional genius with you. And so in the research, they call it a spark, not like the spark in the poem where I was being hurt, but a spark of passion, right? Something that gets you motivated. Many young people in the US find the spark in the arts. Other youth in the US find it in athletics. Let me know if you know your spark, put it in the chat. But the research is clear, family. The young folks who fan this spark, who have a place to go to nurture this flame, they're less depressed. They do better in school, and the community sees less violence. Anybody else other than me like these outcomes? Part of the reason why only 50% of youth know that they have a spark and don't let that spark or that genius blow out is that so many adults do not have the cultural competence to see this genius that resides within you. Like Kaylee, when she got up and spit that poem, that was genius, right? She was interweaving the crisis of the moment and talking about the growth mindset and bringing this message of hope. That was genius, right? And the reality is that there are multiple forms of being a genius or being intelligent. You got the DJ, you got the producer, you got the... You got folks who are expressing with nothing, and that's creating a musical intelligence. You got the poet, the MC, you got the storyteller, that's word smart, graffiti, or, you know, some folks like to sketch, picture smart, breaking, popping, juking, I don't know about twerking, but all of that is body smart. Then you got street knowledge, knowing your environment. You got big question smart. Some of y'all have big questions about the world and life, and that's a very valid form of knowing. Street entrepreneurship, number smart. The promoter is people smart. So in hip hop, everybody has a role. If you're the DJ, you're playing the music. If you can't do that, can you MC and move the crowd? If you can't do that, can you sketch the flyer? If you can't do that, can you do a routine? If you can't do that, can you promote the event? If you can't do that, can you put some purpose into the event and maybe make it a fundraiser for a charity? If you can't do that, can you collect the money at the door? If you can't do that, can you defuse the situation before it escalates? Because if someone gets into a fight, they got to call the popo, and now the party is all over. And in the same way, that everyone has a role to make a hip-hop event work. Everyone has a role to make the community work, to make these schools work. If you're not being engaged to contribute to that environment, then that environment is not one that's allowing everyone to thrive. Kaylee was talking about this in the poem. And it's not just having a form of intelligence, but knowing that that intelligence is like muscle. And the more that you exercise this thing, the stronger it can become. So yeah, you say, oh, I like dancing, but I'm not a genius. The more that you practice, the more that you take time to really exercise that gift, the more you have the capability of being world-class. So the growth mindset says, yes, intelligence is a muscle. The more time you spend on it, the more you can grow that thing. It also is a way of seeing the world that says, you know what? Even if I fail, I'm still going to grow. I'm still going to learn. It's not intimidated by other people's success. If one of your friends is succeeding, you feel inspired. A fixed mindset says, you know what? Either you're smart or you're not. Doesn't matter your effort. And also that fixed mindset says, you know what? If I fail, I'm no good. It's really competitive. And so the encouragement here is what Kaylee started to communicate in her poem, is we got to have that growth mindset. So as this relates to my story, I had a friend of mine who was a real friend, and he said, Berto, you are a hustler. You got to find your legitimate hustle. And I found out that I knew some really amazing artists, and I knew some really amazing folks who made clothing. So I said, you know what? I'm out of this other game. I'm going to create a clothing line. And I started sponsoring DJs and MCs and dancers and visual artists. And I remember I got invited down to the teen center one day, and there was graffiti on the wall. There was other young people who were there who were dancing, other young people. I could hear some music coming around from the background. And I was like, man, this is a pretty vibrant place. And I'm kind of checking it out, and I heard some beats. And, you know, I used to jump in the cypher. Oh, you'll be here now. Estoy hablando, nunca jugando, aunque está listo por lo que estamos preparando. En este año, 2021, and that's how we do it. In Casa Grande, where it's muy caliente. No, I feel it's 100 degrees. Too much blood, so folks might freeze. Go grab the coat, I bring the hope. We do it like this, man, we're not just trying to cope. We're not just trying to survive. We can't keep temperature so we can all fly. And across the continent, yo, we build the continent. You can build the power of your family. And not just be an amateur, but be a professional. Grab the caliber out of the rock. And that's the end of this freestyle hip hop. So, y'all let me have fun over here. I appreciate this. Bob will tell you, and Joe will tell you, I normally do not freestyle on these things. But so I fell in love with this community, family. And we went from doing ciphers and workshops to doing concerts to doing festivals in our community. And I know y'all have the Unity Fest. You weren't able to do it this last year, but I know there's similar things happening in Casa Grande that we need more and more of your voice and energy behind. And I remember finally somebody said, hey, let's do a play. And you know, here I was 19, 20 years old. And I said, man, you know, I'm feeling inspired. I might try to write this play. And we got invited to the Kennedy Center. And I think Lynn Miranda maybe owes me some money because we were doing this stuff before he ever even thought about it. And so so here I was having this moment where, you know, all these opportunities were starting to open up, but I had internalized this idea that I was learning to fish and I really thought I was dumb. And I said, well, if I'm so dumb, how come I'm writing plays and doing all this stuff? And so I said, man, you know what? I'm gonna try to go back to school because maybe I'm not learning to fish and maybe I just learn different, right? And so I go back to school. I'm going to the community college and I don't care about getting good grades. I care about learning knowledge and information that I can use to better serve my community. Now, the interesting thing that happens is when I'm reading or doing a research paper, I'm connecting it to real problems going on in the community. So whereas everybody else is maybe spending, I don't know, 5-10 hours writing a research paper, I'm spending 50 hours. And I'm doing this to really go do some real work. Subsequently, I'm getting very good grades and I'm winning awards and I start coming alive. Because I'm finding my passion is relevant, not just in the community center, but also in my schooling and in my education. And during this time, a major crisis happens where a billionaire in our city decides that he wants to create a musical and artistic center with the classics, with high class arts. And we're low class to him and his people. And so they tell us they're gonna destroy our teen center. They give our administrators a little bit of money, not enough to have another building, but enough to be like hush money. And so now we have to discontinue everything we're doing. And so I bring it to the youth because, you know, the leader said, hey, you can't protest, you can't rally, you can't make a big stink about this openly. And so the youth were like, wait, they're gonna shut down our center? There's no way this can happen. But it was them who had the idea of creating a new play that would tell our story about what this center meant to us, right? How we were able to build beloved community and change the narrative in our lives. And it was a brilliant idea. So we wrote a new play. We talked about racial inequity. We put this whole thing together, had rapping and poetry and acting and dancing, and we invited the Congress people, we invited the mayor, we invited other leaders, and the house was packed. We performed it, the young people got a standing ovation, and then we did a little talk back with the audience, and somebody asked us, does this play have anything to do with that new art center coming up? And isn't your center being destroyed? Like, what's going on? I remember one of the young people came up and said, very funny that you would ask that question. He says, as a matter of fact, it has everything to do with that. We're getting ready to have nowhere where we can go after school and build. And so a lot of different articles came out. I just happened to pick this up today, which is a portfolio of some stuff. But you can see that an article came out. I don't know if y'all can read that. But it says, our play, Seeds of Culture, is hip. Eminem is not worth the hop. So the same person who covered our event covered Eminem's concert. So we're all super geeked, you know, like, dang, man, we got this great recognition. But then it was silence, like nothing happened for a couple of weeks. And we're like, wow, what's going to result? Are we going to be homeless? And I remember I got a call from our congresswoman who said that she heard about the play and heard about what was happening with our center. And she said she was able to earmark $700,000 to go towards a new center. We were able to get that matched. And now in our city in the Midwest, this group of this motley crew of young folks have created a multi-million dollar center, which continues to this day. It's part of their legacy to the city. And there's cooking classes, there's a place to work out, there's a recording studio, a performing arts center, a skateboard park, a gymnasium. And this would have never been the case without the young folks who were involved. For the adults who are in the proverbial digital room, what are the sparks of your youth? Are these sparks being overlooked? How can you incorporate these into your classes and workshops? And to my young leaders, my elders, what are your sparks? How can you fan these into a flame? What challenges are you facing that require a creative solution? And so I want to pause. If y'all got questions, reactions, put it in the chat. Talk to me. We're here. I know there's only 1,500 people in our participant list. I'm giving y'all a hard time. Maybe we will get 1,500 hits of this recording. You never know. Thank you, Joe. Thank you, Tracy, Margo, Amy. All right, so the last stop on this train, if we got time, otherwise, you know, we can wrap it up, is amplifying your voice. How do you spit bars so you split bars? Me and Joe, we like to, you know, wordsmith and sort of use words and make it kind of catchy, whatever. So how do you bring that authentic voice to change the narrative, to bring about this liberation, right? And I love this definition of youth voice because it's defined by youth, an expression of the human spirit shown in different forms like art, words, poetry, music, engaging in the creation of your own opportunity to speak out to authority, believing and putting our voices into practice so youth can be taken seriously. So I'm gonna pause for a minute. Is there a word or a couple of words here that stand out to you? If so, put those in the chat. I can't see you. I don't know if you're in the bathroom right now playing Tetris. If you're here, what word is standing out to you in the chat? Let me know. Opportunities. Yes, that's so huge, isn't it, Annika? You have a voice all day, but if you don't have an opportunity to use your voice, that's a whole nother piece. Potential, spirit, forms of expression, authenticity. Yeah. Thank you. So I'll go through this quickly, but you know, you can actually measure the amount of youth voice in an organization or program. And you can ask these questions. Have you had a leadership role in the last year? Are you allowed to express ideas about activities regarding rules or events? Are you engaged in community problem solving? Have you been or do you plan to be involved in political and civic life? And part of what was helpful for me, I know there's a lot of words here, but a lot of organizations use a youth serving approach, meaning that they are trying to come and fix you. They're trying to do programming and do schooling to you and not with you. And so you're just a passive participant, right? Youth development is a little bit more along the continuum of engagement. Now you're being engaged in a way that's strength-based, right? In a way that maybe is developmentally appropriate. Youth leadership builds off of youth development. So now you're meeting your needs. You're maybe empowered to meet the needs of others. Civic engagement is building off of these other components. And now you're involved with the democratic process of that organization. And really the pinnacle is what they call youth organizing, or something that is youth led, where young people make decisions about what programs are going to happen, what the plan action is going to be, maybe how the budget will be spent. And that is the epitome of authentic youth voice. The problem is that in our society, young people get framed as being hyper-criminalized. It's not, oh, you don't want to give them a voice because you just don't know the chaos, right? And that's so twisted. And this is evident in the kinds of narratives that come out, especially in the news, stories like this one. Check this out.
Meantime, two teenagers are wounded on the city's south side. It happened at East 74th. As an 18-year-old man and 16-year-old girl were hit while standing on the sidewalk. The male's in good condition while the girl's expected to recover. And kids on the street, as young as four, were there to see it all unfold and had a disturbing reaction.
No, I'm not scared of nothing.
When you get older, you're going to stay away from all these guns?
No.
No?
No.
What do you want to do when you get older?
I'm gonna have me a gun.
Because I live right here and I don't want none of my family members to get shot.
That is very scary indeed. So,
so
far,
the
no
story inside that story is about who? The four-year-old boy. And what does he say he wants to have? A gun. Now, based on the information provided in that news story, is he being framed like he is gonna be part of the problem or part of the solution in his community? Tell me in the chat. Now, interesting enough is that this young man is being interviewed. His auntie is there with the cell phone. And so she gets part of the interview that was left on the evening news. Check out what this little boy says.
Boy, that's what I like to hear. You ain't scared of nothing. Damn. When you get older, you're going to stay away from all these guns?
No.
No?
No.
What do you want to do when you get older?
I'm going to have me a gun.
You are? Why do you want to do that? You know what happens when
I'm going to be the police.
Okay,
so
well then,
from
then
the vantage
you can have
point
one.
Of this boy, he says he wants to have a gun for what reason? To be part of to be the police, to be part of the solution. And we got to keep in mind that, that youth criminality has decreased since the 1990s, but the portrayal of young people, particularly young people of color on TV, as criminals has increased over 600%, right? And so if you're not thinking critically, as Kevin was talking about in the beginning, right, what is the default? If you're not around somebody and you don't know how they act and all the information you get is from the television, what is that initial reaction to how somebody's acting, right? And we know that in schools, in particular, students of color are suspended or expelled at 3 times the rate of their white counterparts who are oftentimes doing the same thing, right? In my situation, I was told I was learning deficient. I found out later on that students of color are oftentimes misdiagnosed as being special education, 6 times more than our white counterparts. And these couple of things lead to folks dropping out. And a dropout is 8 times more likely to be incarcerated than someone with a high school diploma. And so many people call this the school-to-prison pipeline, especially when you look at what happens legally. And we know that men of color are oftentimes tried, convicted, and serve longer sentences, 8 times more than their white counterpart who commit the same crime, who have the same record. And at its very worst, a young man might be reaching for his phone or out late one night and is seen as a threat, and there's no questions that are asked, and maybe his life is taken because no one can see the sculpture. They only see the stone that the media has been portraying to them. So some terminology, and I'm gonna wrap this up, that I want y'all to learn is this idea of microaggression. When you come into an environment and you are treated like a criminal, or you're treated like you're not smart, or you're treated like you don't have anything to contribute, that's a microaggression. And the research articulates 3 different kinds of microaggressions. One is a micro assault, which can be intentional, verbal or non-verbal attack. You got the micro insults that are maybe not as intentional, right? But they're still insensitive. Rude put downs that are subtly aimed at someone's racial heritage or identity. The micro invalidations or remarks that dismiss, diminish, or invalidate someone's reality, their history, the culture of their people. And keep in mind that in public education today, we have more stories about bears and animal life than we do about people of color, right? And far more stories of white folks and white folks' history than we ever hear about with students of color. And this is causing harm when we are not being affirmed in our brilliance and our capability to contribute historically or in this present day. So the last story I'm just gonna quickly share is I graduated from community college. I went to UW-Madison and I came in not just wanting to be schooled, but wanted to be educated. The only problem is I was so turned on for learning. I wanted to study 10 majors. And I thought I might have to be in school forever. And I finally came across something that said that you could create your own major. So I went to my school counselor. His name was Ben. And I burst into his office. I said, Ben, I'm not going to be here for 10 years. I'm going to create my own major. And Ben shut down. And he shut me down and he's like, I've been in this university for so many years and no one's been able to do this, and just totally crushed my idea, right? Micro assault. I was like, felt like I had a couple of wounds walking out of the office. I took some time to pray, some time to meditate. And I realized when I read a piece of poetry by Robert Frost, the direction that I needed to take, the poem said that two roads diverge in the wood. And I took the one less traveled, and that's made all the difference. So I went back to Ben, I said, I have to try this. Even if I fail, I need to try to create my own major. He must have saw the determination in my eyes. So he told me what I needed to do. I needed to find a similar major at a university. I needed to come up with the curriculum. I needed to defend it. I put it all together and I found myself in front of a board of professors and deans from across the university, and they tore my proposal up. But I realized that the energy they were coming at me with was an energy I was familiar with. When I used to be in rap battles, and people used to try to publicly humiliate me. So then I felt a little comfortable in the space. I said, oh, they're trying to battle. So then I started pulling out my portfolio. I said, look, the major that I'm trying to create is not something I'm pulling out of the air. We've been doing this work in the community. Look, here is a list. This ain't the list. It's just a picture my son made, but I'm gonna use it. This here is a list of your contemporaries and your peers who have signed on to my major. And I, again, it wasn't a picture of Plants for Zombies. That's my kid giving me a little present. And so I started to battle back, right? But I realized, Annika, that they had already made their decision before I walked in the door. And so I said, oh. And then I had a flashback to when I saw an MC battle once, and there was this kid who was in the battle, and the guy who was the reigning champion for, I don't know, like 20 weeks, and the kid did really good. Now he had to battle the main guy, and he had to go first, and he went, and he did pretty good. And then he did something unexpected. He went to pass the mic, and he drops the mic, and he walks off stage like he already left. And I got the idea, I gotta drop the mic on these people. So I start packing up my bag in the middle of the meeting, and I start walking out. And they said, Mr. Rivera, where are you going? We haven't concluded the meeting yet. I said, no, it is concluded, because I see where this is going. I don't want you to waste my time anymore. You know, I have good enough grades. I'm just going to go to Harvard. I thought you all wanted to be on the cutting edge of education, but I was wrong. And now they're like, well, Mr. Rivera, let us, can we just take a break here and let us, so they make me leave the room. And, you know, I'm out there sweating a little bit. I'm like, I don't know anybody at Harvard. Like, I'm talking out the side of my neck, you know? And so I go back in the room, and the demeanor changed a little bit. And they said, okay, Mr. Rivera, this major social change, youth culture and the arts, we will approve it on a couple conditions. We want every class that you take to be advanced. And I said, well, what does that mean? They said, you'll be taking a variety of classes, but it'll be with people getting their master's degrees and PhDs. And I heard that old voice that said I was learning deficient, but I also heard the voices of my heroes and the young people I was working with saying, this is your opportunity, you gotta take it. So I said, if that's the only way you'll accept my major, let's do it. So I got in this space where everything I was doing, I was connecting it to the community. Long story short, I graduated with honors. And a year later, the university calls me back. And they said, you know, we thought your major was a pretty good idea. We want to create a learning community where other spoken word poets and hip hop artists from around the world can get a free 4-year academic scholarship to come to this school. Can we hire you as a consultant? And I was like, sure. And so little did I know that that battle wasn't just for me, but was for hundreds of young people that will come behind me. Couple questions, we're gonna wrap this up. How can the level of youth voice be turned up in your community, your organization, or your program? And to the adults who are here, are you teaching your young people about microaggressions? If not, I challenge you to teach them what this is. Young people knowing this empowers them. They can name some of the stuff that's coming up in their lives. My youth, how can your voice be heard on matters that affect you? Yes, organizing a conference is a great start, but we need your voice integrated in every institution. How are you experiencing these microaggressions? I want to challenge you to start calling these things out. Now is the time for a change. In conclusion, how do we go to pain to propane? How do we change this narrative and this tune of surviving to thriving? Family, we got to sample consciousness. We got to sample from the elders and the records of history. You have to be a yelder to other folks to sample from. You got to remix your gifts, your passion, your intelligence, that growth mindset, and use your voice to bring liberation, to bring a new kind of environment where everyone is included, everyone belongs, everyone can contribute. I'll end with a question. What if all this death and all this sickness and all of this despair, all of this crap, what if this is the compost for us creating an environment where we can grow and break through the surface and make for a better tomorrow and create the conditions for healing and thriving for ourselves and for our community? And I lied. I have one last quote. Cesar Chavez says, "One social change begins, it cannot be reversed. You cannot uneducate the person who has learned how to read. You cannot humiliate the person who feels pride. You cannot oppress the people who are not afraid anymore." Thank you for letting me participate in this conference. The best to you all. And I'm here to support a few miles down the road. And I hope to be there in person later this year. Peace.